invite Dr. Ajit Gupta for his presentation. He's going to be talking to us on cone beam CT dactylocystography. Dr. Ajit is on similar to Dr. Swati, trained at PGI Chandigarh, followed by a fellowship at LV Prasad and a double fellowship, second one in oculofacial plastic surgery at Jules Stein in California. And he is now spread over Maharashtra in Mumbai and Pune, with primarily in the Mumbai Eye Plastic Surgery Center in Mumbai. And he and Prerna together are the young guns in oculofacial aesthetic surgery in Mumbai. And he'll be talking to us on cone beam CT.
Thank you, Akshay. Thank you, Nandini and Javed, for making me a part of this wonderful focused group webinar, which is, I think, the way for the future. So my talk has been made very simple by Swati, because my talk is an offshoot of what her talk was. And luckily, I feel a fish out of water in this webinar, but I try to do my best. Luckily, I'm talking about some technology, which basically has come to the forefront recently. And I'll talk you through how it is done, how it is performed, how advantageous it is for us in our day-to-day practice, and how useful it can be in certain case scenarios. So all of us agree, especially experienced lacrimal surgeons, that although evolution is the way forward, in lacrimal surgery, probing and syringing remain the gold standard in hands of experienced surgeons. Mostly around 90% and maybe even 95% of the cases can be diagnosed just by simple probing and irrigation. But as we evolve, we need to take into accordance all the technologies that we have at hand to treat the remaining 5% of the patients. And that is where the role of DCG comes in. Now, Swati has already very well highlighted about the CT and MR DCG both, but all technologies have certain limitations, and CT DCG basically limits itself in being less dynamic. In both the technologies, you see that the patient is mostly in supine position, which I would consider as a non-physiological position for drainage of tears. The radiation exposure is 10 times higher, as shown by studies, in CT DCG as compared to a cone beam CT. An MRI, although lacks radiation exposure, it is advantageous that there's no radiation exposure, but the long imaging time and sequencing is a con. The cost of an MRI DCG would be much higher than a CT DCG. Again, you have to be supine in a small gantry, so it's no strict no-no for claustrophobic patients. And lack of bony delineation is one more limitation of an MR-DCG. Now, bony limitation is a very big factor, because around 50% of our lacrimal system lies in the bone. So we need to know the bony anatomy, especially in complicated cases. Now, how CT, cone beam CT came to the forefront was basically by our dentistry friends and colleagues. They used to use it a lot in the 1990s, especially for getting scans of the jawbone, tumors of the jawbone, and also in cases of maxillofacial trauma. The biggest advantage of a cone beam CT is that it just can lie in one corner of the room with good radiation protection. It occupies very little space and doesn't have those stringent norms as to a normal CT scanning machine. The difference between a cone beam CT versus a conventional CT is that cone beam CT basically uses angiography C-arm principles. So the X-ray projection is in a conical fashion. As you see here, it is basically a cone which is left from the X-ray machine, and there is a detector around 180 degrees apart with the patient lying in the patient sitting in the center. This is a better description of how it is being performed. Now, this is one of the cone beam CTs which I was privileged to use when I was at UCLA. You see that the patient is sitting in the gantry. This is the X-ray coupler, and this is the X-ray beam projection machine. And this whole thing moves 360 degrees to capture a sequence. Before we go into the details, usually this, if I reviewed quite a few papers, and usually the technique which is used to get a cone beam scan is that a contrast medium is applied in the form of drops at 0, 5, and 10 minutes, after which the scan is performed at 15 minutes. The time to take a whole sequence of around 360 degrees depends on the field of view and the slice thickness that you determine, which can be varied. In cases of dactylocystogram, 6 by 8 centimeters field of view is more than enough to to localize the anatomy between the upper canaliculus to the NLD, or sometimes an extended field of view in cases of fracture can be taken, and the field of view can be extended to almost 12 to 15 centimeters in these machines. But beware, as you increase the field of view, the spatial resolution decreases and the contrast reduces. Slice thickness of around 0.5 millimeters can be achieved, and even lesser slice thickness can be achieved in certain machines. Now, the whole sequencing takes around 17.5 to 20 seconds. So it's a very small, short image acquisition time. The patient is comfortable. He's sitting on the chair. There is a headrest which secures to reduce any motion artifacts, which are more commonly seen in MR and CT DCG when the patient is lying down and goes inside the gantry. So motion artifacts are completely reduced. Now, as I have already mentioned, that most lacrimal outflow obstruction can be effectively assessed with probing. So why do we need a cone beam CT? So when we went in and reviewed literature, there were two prominent publications, by a German group and another by a Swiss group. This paper came in 2008, where they did a cone beam CT along with digital subtraction dacrocystography in a group of 45 patients, out of which around 48 had a patent NLD but was symptomatic. And 37 had an obstruction, out of which 18 had an incomplete obstruction, while the other few patients had a complete obstruction. What significantly came out of this paper was they also could study the bony anatomy of the NLD in such patients, and they found out that there was a significant difference between both the sides. The bony anatomy on the affected side was stenotic as compared to the normal side, and they could measure the dimensions of the NLD and the other parts of the system as well. These are some beautiful images which has been published in this paper. This is one patient where you can see the digital subtraction angiography scan here in the top left corner. This is a cone beam CT scan of the same patient showing a stenosis at the lower NLD junction. Similarly, the dye is seen in the NLD. And what came out here was a beautiful diverticulum and a dacryocele, which was seen on 3D reconstruction of the same images. Similarly, I found this image also very interesting because this wouldn't be diagnosed on a routine syringing. You can see that the dye is highlighting the canaliculi. It is going into the lacrimal sac. And here you can see there are two passages for the passage of dye on either side. And here in the CT imaging, you can see a big contrast defect here in the center. So when they operated this patient, it turned out to be a case of dacryolith. So dacryolith can be very well shown in a cone beam CT. Now, this paper was a game changer because although their population size was less, what they did was, in contrast to the previous paper where they did a manual irrigation, this evaluated cone beam CT efficacy in 5 patients manually with irrigation, and secondly, in the other 5 patients, it was done passively where drops were instilled. The previous paper had syringing as a way of putting the dye inside the system. Now, this paper also concluded that the passive way of doing a cone beam CT is more physiological and sometimes can diagnose irrigation outflow disorders. Now, advantages of a cone beam CT over a normal CT scan would be that it can be used as an adjunct investigation. The upright physiological position is a good advantage. It is a passive study when you instill drops, lesser radiation exposure as compared to a conventional CT, almost 10 times less. It gives adequate bony anatomical details, quicker acquisition times, which is 15 minutes, complete procedure gets over, the patient can walk in and walk out, and it's certainly cheaper than the normal variant of a CT scan. So if you do a study, you see that in the US, a cone beam CT scan would cost anywhere between $100 to $500, while a CT scan of the same amount would cost 10 times more. Even in India, where I get it done, it costs around 2,000 rupees, which is a minimal amount when you want to. Now, I'll talk a little bit about our limited experience of this modality. We did a small study when I was a fellow at UCLA, where patients with unilateral or bilateral epiphora, the cause unknown, underwent probing and irrigation and CBCT by the same examiner. You see these images which were taken. This was done on a Philips cone beam CT at UCLA, and you see the dye passing through very well on the left-hand side. It has come into the inferior meatus while there is a block here. Similarly, in this case, you can see that there is an obstruction in the post-sacral region, while here the dye doesn't go beyond the canaliculus. So there's a canalicular block. In this case, you can very well see that the dye has come down right into the inferior turbinate, while there is a block here and stasis of the dye in the NLD, causing a highlighting, and a dacryolith has been found here in this. So very well, the images are almost as similar to a normal conventional CT scan with less radiation exposure. Here you can see what Dr. Javed was talking about in his talk, where you can see that the NLD is not regularly wide. There is a stenosis of the NLD in the middle portion, and down there is a dilatation. So here that can be very well highlighted. So this is an advantage. And on the left hand side, there is a block at the proximal NLD junction. Now 3D rendering is one more big advantage of this. So although it's not a very high quality imaging, but it helps very well in cases of post maxillectomy trauma, and especially in cases where PET has been done, as Akruti was pointing out, and in cases of secondary acquired lacrimal duct obstruction. In our study, out of the 45 patients, 84 lacrimal systems were analyzed, of which 21 were asymptomatic eyes, just for control to get a hang of how to use the machine and how to go ahead, and 63 symptomatic eyes. Now, CBCT correlated with symptoms in 57% of the cases, while irrigation correlated with symptoms in 54% of the case, patients. So symptom correlation was not significantly different. So this again proves that you should not substitute irrigation for a cone beam CT. Irrigation and CBCT specificity were almost same, with irrigation specificity being higher. The other findings which were of good importance were that a dacryolith was found, which would not have been found otherwise on a probing or irrigation. And it also demonstrated the presence of certain nasal anomalies, which might help you when you're planning an endonasal TCR in certain cases, subgroup of patients. So there was a good concordance between irrigation and CBCT, especially in patients without canalicular obstruction. So to conclude, the CBCT has potential to identify canalicular obstruction when probing irrigation cannot. It demonstrates high specificity but low sensitivity, and gives additional information regarding the regional anatomy. Proposed applications of a cone beam CT could be in cases of complex CNLDOs, where the patient is adult enough to sit on this gantry, saldos, epiphero in anatomically patent systems, post lacrimal and canalicular tear repair patients, where you are doing a monocast stent and want to know why the epiphora still persists after the stent is removed, or in ostium flow dynamic studies post endonasal DCR. Thank you. I would like to acknowledge my colleagues who helped me during this study at UCLA.
Thanks, Adip. That was a quick and in-depth overview. Any of the panelists have any other comments to make? Any of the other speakers? So, Dr. Javed, I had a question. Do you think that, you know, in terms of all the diagnoses that we've seen, NLDO, SALDO, post-traumatic NLDO, when you compare cone beam CT versus CT DCG or MR DCG, and Swati, feel free to chip in, any specific diagnosis where you feel this investigative modality has a higher sensitivity in diagnosing this versus the other?
Let me just congratulate Adit for a fantastic talk. I think cone beam is something that is still not taken up well in our country. And I think this talk should propel us to investigate a lot of things that he was talking about in canaliculitis, incisional versus non-incisional, curettage. These are areas which are absolutely not touched. So, you know, I feel that going forward, it has a lot of potential applications, and the way the techniques that Adit and his group at UCLA have described is something which is simple and can easily be performed without much discomfort to the patient. So I think that's going forward, that's probably a way to go in the future. Regarding Akshay's question, I don't think there is, it's very difficult, because I still feel is a very, very underdeveloped branch of lacrimal sciences. It's something that has not been so very well studied, right from anatomy to pathology and diseases. There are certain things of exclusion that you can say that probably dacryocytography is something that I wouldn't do in today's times, because it's one is cumbersome and it has absolute no great information that it gives. FDDT would give me equally good information about the functional flow rather than a DSG. So other than DSG, I think CTDCG, MRDCG, cone beam that Adit was talking about, I think these are still some modalities that needs to be explored.
Thank you, Adit.